Hey, Saints, and soon to be Saints. So this morning, I woke up and just kind of laying in bed, praying, and sometimes the Lord works with me, like, with real, like, with just simplicity and childlike faith. And because to me, the gospel is simple, and it's so, anyways, as I'm laying there seeking the Lord, the thought had come to me, how well can I fight the enemy, like in a physical battle, if I had no arms? And I'm like, well, not very good, Lord, unless I was like trained in kickboxing. But the truth is he was showing me like the power, and he's been showing me the power of the unity of the body of Christ. And something that like really has been standing out to me is in Ephesians 5, when it talks about the husband loving the wife. And there's a scripture in there in Ephesians 5 that goes on about the husband loving his own body, you know, and if so, if he loves, you know, if he's hungry, he's gonna feed himself, and so he should also do to his wife. And then Paul skips a couple verses, and then it says, but this is a mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. And though it's super true for husbands and wives in the natural, it's also like even more so true for the body of Christ as the bride and how we love each other. And so what he's saying there, like, if I'm hungry and I feed myself, I need to treat my wife the same, like, where, okay, are you hungry? I need to look out for her. And you go to Proverbs 31, and it talks about the virtuous woman. But in reality, Proverbs 31 is the virtuous bride of Christ. And I'm not even going into that one, because it's not too much, but how well can I fight the enemy if I'm all by myself? And how well can I fight the enemy if I'm all by myself with no arms? And you go into Acts 12, verse 12, and you see they were all at John Mark's mom's house in Jerusalem, and they were praying. They were all gathered together, and they were praying. And Peter was in prison, and what happens? We know the story. That, you know, they're in there praying, the chains break off of Peter, the angels come, let him out of prison, and they go, and he knocks on the door right where they're praying, and they saw the answer to their prayer. And I've actually witnessed this. Yesterday I talked about these bodies of Christ that I've been blessed to be fortunate with. One of them, well, actually, both, all of them, but I wanted to share the story of one of them. One of them had a member of their church was in the hospital, and the doctors couldn't figure out a problem. And so we all gathered and we all prayed with the intent of this person's healing. And lo and behold, it came. But we gathered together as one unit. We were all together. The body of Christ was there. So when we go out and we fight anything that there is to fight, or whatever it is going on in life, there really should be no lack among us. There should be, whether it's financially, whether it's provisions of food, toilet paper, whatever, there should be no lack amongst us. And there's a really super good possibility, because this is another word that I had heard. Radio's a little loud. When I was praying, I heard the word test run. And I thought, oh, that's kind of funny. What if this is like part of a test run? Like, we're flipping out. Well, so I'm not. Other people maybe, but about everything that's going on. I got a phone call last night from a brother that was like really scared. And he's like, aren't you scared? And I'm like, no, not at all. I mean, what is there to be scared of? And I'm not coming down on anyone that is fearful, and because this is a little goofy. But I'm not fearful because I know my Jesus, and I've seen his power manifested through the body when they become one unit. And because if you look at a body, we all have, each member has its own purpose. And I believe I heard test run, because it's like, are we going to become unified as one body in this deal, or are we going to fend for ourselves? I had seen pictures on Facebook, like I'm sure the rest of us have, of people hoarding toilet paper and all these other things, and it's like, whatever. But are we going to do this as his body, or are we going to be able to come together and be one, where there will be no lack amongst us? Yeah, it's just beautiful. It's beautiful because if you look at the body as a whole, being one man, which is Christ, it's like, what can't Jesus do? He can do all things. All things are possible. And can he do all things through one individual? He can do whatever he wants. But I really believe that he would rather have us all come together as one and seek his heart and pray. This is a good one. This actually drives me nuts because I hear this all the time. Well, where two or three are gathered, that's church. That's taken so far out of context. If you keep that in context, it's Matthew 18. And it's talking about binding and loosening. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loosen on earth will be loosened in heaven. Or is it loosened in heaven, loosened on earth? I don't know. One of the two. And then it says, where two or three of you are gathered, or I am in the midst of you. Well, why is he there? Because Jesus knows the spiritual law way back in Deuteronomy that says, you need two or three witnesses to establish a matter. So even when it comes to establishing the matter of binding and loosening, which we have this authority in Christ to do, and the cool thing is when we come together as one, God, like, I believe that God actually comes in a greater way. I believe that he comes to look in, and the angels even says that the angels look upon us to see the ways of God, to see. And it's like, so when we come together as one unit, and the angels are going to be like, I want to check these guys out, they're looking through, and the Lord shows up, where two or three are gathered, there I am in the midst of you, to what? To back up what we say, because when we come together, we're going to hear clearly, I'm going to have confirmation, and one person will hear this, one person will hear this, we're actually functioning as the body, now we know the will of the Father, and now we know what to pray, and like it says in Amos, it says, for the Lord says this, he says, for I can do nothing without first telling my prophets. So we're like, Lord, why come you're not doing this? And the Lord's like, because you're not hearing me. Because I established this is a lie, not a man that I shall lie. And I had said, for I can do nothing without first telling my prophets. So we need to have ears to hear and eyes to see of what's going on here. And guess what? What if I'm an eye and you're an ear? Well, we need to come together so that we can hear and that we can see and that we can go and do. It's beautiful how the Lord did this because when we come together, what are we doing? I'm loving my neighbor. We're fulfilling the gospel by being the body of Christ. But a lot of us are like, well, I don't want to give all of myself, and you're only hurting yourself. Because God's going to fill that void wherever you're not, but yet he'd rather use you. And then when he uses you, it's like Jesus says in John 17, he says that my joy in you, when you're doing the will of the Father, when you're as one as the Father and I are one, then that my joy in you is full. Jesus' joy in us is full because we're doing exactly how he had planned this to be, and he's overjoyed with us. And if we have the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is what? My strength. And if I'm strong, and it's like nothing can come against us. Nothing, because we serve the most powerful, amazing Creator, Father in heaven. And so today I just really want to encourage everybody, like, to really seek out the truth of what the body of Christ looks like. You know, it may not look like you think. It may not look like going to church for a couple hours on Sunday with our hands raised for an hour and then hearing a message and then we go home, and maybe that doesn't look like that. Maybe it looks like doing life together. Maybe it looks like taking people in and loving them. You know, like, I'm thinking of the scripture, you know, in, I don't know where it's at. It's in the Leviticus, Exodus, Numbers. I don't know. But it talks about leaving the corners of your field for strangers to come. Why to feed the strangers? You leave the edges of your field, and so if someone comes by that's hungry, that they can be fed from your bountiful harvest. And it's still the same. The law is the foreshadow of the love of Christ, and what? I don't even want to go into that stuff because I'll get on a sidetrack. But here we go, people. This could be a test run. And are we going to love each other? Are we going to come together? And are we going to come together and pray? Are we going to be the Acts 12:12 church where if someone is imprisoned in their mind, someone is imprisoned with a lack of food, someone is imprisoned with a lack of toilet paper, or if someone is really falsely in prison for like Peter was, are we going to come together as one unit and pray, seek the heart of God, declare His word, hear, and do? It's beautiful. It's beautiful. It just is. I've experienced the power of God. I've experienced the power of God with this oneness of everybody coming together and giving all and surrendering all. And so I just want to encourage everybody to think about this today, about, you know, really the being unified, you know, and finding your role. And it's just awesome. It's just really good. And I'm thinking of the scripture right now, that no man ought to think what he's not, or something like that. And I think all of us, not all of us, some of us sometimes we're not happy with what we have to do. But yet if we know that we're doing all things unto the Lord, we can find joy in it. Somehow we can find joy in whatever the Lord has us doing. And like, whether it's your work or whatever it is, but I know there's no greater joy than when His joy in me is fulfilled because I'm doing His will. And there's not one that's above the other. You know, when Jesus was casting out the demon from the demoniac, was not any more powerful or not any more significant than when he was alone at night praying, because both of them were the will of the Father at that time. And so there's no one is more than the other. It's not. It's about coming together, being one in the Lord. So I hope this helps somebody, and I really hope this edifies you to maybe like really look at the scriptures if you need to and be like, is this guy nuts? Or is this really what we're designed to do? To meet together, to break bread together, so that there is no lack amongst us. So I love you guys. Be super blessed today, because that perfect love casts out fear. You know, and I think that all of us, if we go through something alone, it's really hard. But if we can go through it with like-minded people, that afflictions and everything else become much easier when we have those that love us and that we love us by our side. So, and then when we get to be alone, we're vulnerable to the wolves. So, okay, love you guys. You're super blessed.